when it comes to a quest for truth, we all need to understand that we really do approach things with a personal bias. And our reading of the scripture is no different. Many times we approach the scriptures with a very specific bias, a preconceived idea, whether it's pre-trib rapture, dispensation theology, globe, what have you. We hear things from somebody else and form opinions about those things in our mind and think we are settled on what we consider to be a truth. And then we go look at the scriptures and bend, twist, and distort the scriptures to try to make them fit our preconceived ideas. And we have to learn how to test all things. We have to realize that we are approaching truth with personal biases, and we have to try to put those personal biases aside and look at the evidence objectively. And I'm going to ask you to do that with this episode. I'm going to ask you to try to put all your preconceived ideas aside as we look through the scriptures. Now, this brings us to the section called Allowing the Bible to Speak for Itself. Below are a number of Bible verses without commentary. Unless otherwise noted, all the scriptures are taken from the King James Version. Pretending you have never heard of a globe or even a flat earth before, let's just allow the Bible to speak for itself. Read them over a couple of times, asking the Holy Spirit to reveal to you what they mean. Without forcing an interpretation based on preconceived notions, meditate on them and ask yourself, what is the Bible really showing me concerning the nature of the heavens, the earth, the sun, moon, and stars? Then in the next section after this one, I will give my commentary on these scriptures, revealing what I believe they are saying to me. The scriptures below are arranged by topics in order to set the stage for what will follow. I have placed the book of Job before Genesis, as many, if not most, scholars believe it is the oldest book of the Bible. And I have also emphasized words in bold for us to consider as we read. This is by no means an exhaustive list of scriptures. It is essentially just a first run, which I will continue to add to as I find more in the future. These were just kind of my own search through keywords, you know, when I was just kind of doing a keyword search through scriptures that I was trying to find addresses and whatnot, and whatever I could find concerning the nature of the firmament, heavens, earth, sun, moon, stars, and that sort of thing. So again, it's not an exhaustive list. It's just the ones on my first run attempt. These are the ones that I came up with. So arranged by topic, no commentary, just bold for emphasis to consider. Here are scriptures concerning the nature of the heavens / sky above and their relationship to the earth. Job 9, 6 through 8, which shaketh the earth out of her place, and the pillars thereof tremble, which commandeth the sun, and it riseth not, and sealeth up the stars, which alone spreadeth out the heavens, and treadeth upon the waves of the sea. Job 22:14. Thick clouds are a covering to him that he seeth not, and he walketh in the circuit of heaven. Same verse in the Holman Christian Standard Bible reads, the circle of the sky. The American Standard Version reads, walketh on the vault of heaven. Job 26, verses 7 through 13. He stretcheth out the north over the empty place, and hangeth the earth upon nothing. He bindeth up the waters in his thick clouds, and the cloud is not rent under them. He holdeth back the face of his throne, and spreadeth his cloud upon it. He hath compassed the waters with bounds, until the day and night come to an end. The pillars of heaven tremble, and are astonished at his reproof. He divideth the sea with his power, and by his understanding he smiteth through the proud. By his spirit he hath garnished the heavens, his hand hath formed the crooked serpent. Job 37:18. Hast thou with him spread out the sky, which is strong and as a molten looking glass? Genesis 1, verses 1 through 8. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. And God said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it divide the waters from the waters. And God made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which were above the firmament, and it was so. And God called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day.
Genesis 7:11. In the 600th year of Noah's life, in the second month, and the 17th day of the month, the same day were all the fountains of the great deep broken up, and the windows of heaven were opened. Genesis 8:2. The fountains also of the deep and the windows of heaven were stopped, and the rain from heaven was restrained. 2 Samuel 2:8. Then the earth shook and trembled. The foundations of heaven moved and shook, because he was wroth.
Psalm 19:1. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork.
Psalm 29:10. The Lord sitteth upon the flood. Yea, the Lord sitteth king forever. Psalm 78:21-25. Therefore the Lord heard this, and was wroth. So a fire was kindled against Jacob, and anger also came up against Israel, because they believed not in God, and trusted not in his salvation. Though he had commanded the clouds from above, and opened the doors of heaven, and had rained down manna upon them to eat, and had given them of the corn of heaven, man did eat angels' food. He sent them meat to the full. Psalm 104:1-3.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord my God, thou art very great. Thou art clothed with honor and majesty, who coverest thyself with light as with a garment, who stretchest out the heavens like a curtain, who layeth the beams of his chambers in the waters, who maketh the clouds his chariot, who walketh upon the wings of the wind.
Psalm 148:4. Praise him, ye heavens of heavens, and ye waters that be above the heavens. Proverbs 8:27. When he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he set a compass upon the face of the depth. Same verse in the English Standard Version reads, when he inscribed a circle on the face of the deep. Isaiah 13:13. Therefore I will shake the heavens, and the earth shall remove out of her place, in the wrath of the Lord of hosts, and in the day of his fierce anger.
Isaiah 40:22. It is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, and the inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers, that stretcheth out the heavens as a curtain, and spreadeth them out as a tent to dwell in.
In the International Standard Version, it says, he's the one who sits above the disk of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers. He's the one who stretches out the heavens like a curtain, and spreads them like a tent to dwell in.
Isaiah 44:24. Thus saith the Lord, thy Redeemer, and he that formed thee from the womb. I am the Lord that maketh all things, that stretcheth forth the heavens alone, that spreadeth abroad the earth by myself. Isaiah 45:12. I have made the earth and created man upon it. I, even my hands, have stretched out the heavens, and all their hosts have I commanded. Isaiah 48:13. Mine hand also hath laid the foundation of the earth, and my right hand hath spanned the heavens. When I call unto them, they stand up together. Isaiah 66:1. Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that ye build unto me? And where is the place of my rest?
Ezekiel 1:26. And above the firmament that was over their heads was the likeness of a throne, and as the appearance of a sapphire stone, and upon the likeness of the throne was the likeness as the appearance of a man above upon it. Amos 9:6. It is he that buildeth his stories in the heaven, and hath founded his troop in the earth. He that calleth for the waters of the sea, and poureth them out upon the face of the earth, the Lord is his name. In the American Standard Version it reads, he that buildeth his chambers in the heavens, and hath founded his vault upon the earth. Also in the English Standard Version, he that buildeth his chambers in the heaven, and hath founded his vault upon the earth. In the Darby translation, he that buildeth his upper chambers in the heavens, and hath founded his vault upon the earth. And in the New American Standard Bible, it says, the one who builds his upper chambers in the heavens, and has founded his vaulted dome over the earth.
Okay, those, while they did have stuff, some things in there concerning the earth, were primarily scriptures dealing with the heaven and the firmament that is known as the heaven. Here are scriptures concerning the nature of the earth below the firmament. Job 9:6. which shaketh the earth out of her place, and the pillars thereof tremble. Job 26:7, he stretcheth out the north over the empty space, and hangeth the earth upon nothing. Job 26:10, he hath compassed the waters with bounds, until the day and night come to an end. Job 28:24, for he looketh to the ends of the earth, and seeth under the whole heaven. Job 37:3, he directeth it under the whole heaven, and his lightning unto the ends of the earth. Job 38, verses 1 through 7. Then the Lord answered Job out of the whirlwind and said, who is this that darkeneth counsel by words without knowledge? Gird up now thy loins like a man, for I will demand of thee, and answer thou me. Where wast thou when I laid the foundations of the earth? Declare, if thou hast understanding, who hath laid the measures thereof, if thou knowest? Or who hath stretched the line upon it? Whereupon are the foundations thereof fastened? Or who laid the cornerstone thereof, when the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy? Job 38:13, that it might take hold of the ends of the earth, that the wicked might be shaken out of it. Genesis 1, verses 9 through 13. And God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering together of the waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth bring forth grass, the herb yielding seed, and the fruit tree yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth grass and herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind. And God saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the third day. 1 Samuel 2:8, he raiseth up the poor out of the dust, and lifted up the beggar from the dunghill, to set them among princes, and to make them inherit the throne of glory. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he hath set the world upon them. 2 Samuel 22:16. And the channels of the sea appeared, the foundations of the world were discovered, at the rebuking of the Lord, at the blast of the breath of his nostrils. 1 Chronicles 16:30. Fear before him, all the earth, the world also shall be stable, that it be not moved. Psalm 18:15. Then the channels of waters were seen, the foundations of the world were discovered at thy rebuke, O Lord, at the blast of the breath of thy nostrils.
Psalm 75:3. The earth and all the inhabitants thereof are dissolved. I bear up the pillars of it. Selah.
Psalm 93:1. The Lord reigneth. He is clothed with majesty. The Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he hath girded himself. The world also is established, that it cannot be moved. Psalm 96, verses 9 through 11. O worship the Lord, O in the beauty of holiness. Fear before him, all the earth. Say among the heathen that the Lord reigneth. The world also shall be established, that it shall not be moved. He shall judge the people righteously. Let the heavens rejoice, and let the earth be glad. Let the sea roar and the fullness thereof. Psalm 102:25. Of old hast thou laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thy hands. Psalm 104, verses 5 through 9. Who laid the foundations of the earth, that it should not be removed forever? Thou coverest it with the deep, as with a garment. The waters stood above the mountains. At thy rebuke they fled. At the voice of thy thunder they hasted away. They go up by the mountains, they go down by the valleys into the places which thou hast founded for them. Thou hast set a bound that they may not pass over, that they turn not again to cover the earth. Psalm 136, 6, to him that stretched out the earth above the waters, for his mercy endureth forever. Proverbs 8, 27 through 29, when he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he set a compass upon the face of the depth, when he established the clouds above, when he strengthened the fountains of the deep, when he gave to the sea his decree, that the waters should not pass his commandment, when he appointed the foundations of the earth, Isaiah 11:12, and he shall set up an ensign for the nations, and shall assemble the outcasts of Israel, and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth.
Isaiah 13:13, therefore I will shake the heavens, and the earth shall remove out of her place, in the wrath of the Lord of hosts, and in the day of his fierce anger.
Isaiah 40:22, it is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth, and the inhabitants thereof are as grasshoppers, that stretcheth out the heavens as a curtain, and spreadeth them out as a tent to dwell in.
In the International Standard Version, it says, he who sits upon the disk of the earth.
Isaiah 43:6. I'll say to the north, give them up, and to the south, don't keep them back. Bring my sons from far away and my daughters from the ends of the earth. Daniel 4:10-11. Thus were the visions of mine head in my bed. I saw, and behold, a tree in the midst of the earth, and the height thereof was great. The tree grew and was strong, and the height thereof reached unto heaven, and the sight thereof to the end of all the earth.
Jonah 2:6. I went down to the bottoms of the mountains. The earth with her bars was about me forever. Yet hast thou brought up my life from corruption, O Lord my God.
Matthew 4:8-9. Again, the devil taketh him up into an exceeding high mountain, and showeth him all the kingdoms of the world, and the glory of them, and saith unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. Matthew 24:31. And he shall send his angels with a great sound of a trumpet, and they shall gather together his elect from the four winds, from one end of heaven to the other. John 17:24. Father, I desire that they also, whom thou hast given me, may be with me where I am, to behold my glory, which thou hast given me in thy love for me before the foundation of the world. Revelation 1:7. Behold, he cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him, and they also which pierced him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of him. Even so, amen. Revelation 7:1. And after these things, I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on sea, nor on any tree. Revelation 28. He will go out to deceive Gog and Magog, the nations at the four corners of the earth, and gather them for war. They are as numerous as the sands of the seashore. Scriptures concerning the nature of the sun, moon, and stars.
Job 38:7. When the morning stars sang together, and all the sons of God shouted for joy.
Genesis 1:14-18. And God said, let there be lights in the firmament of the heaven to divide the day from the night, and let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years, and let them be for lights in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made the stars also. And God set them in the firmament of the heaven to give light upon the earth and to rule over the day and over the night and to divide the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good.
Deuteronomy 4:19. And lest thou lift up thine eyes unto heaven, and when thou seest the sun and the moon and the stars, even all the hosts of heaven, shouldest be driven to worship them and serve them, which the Lord thy God hath divided unto all nations under the whole heaven.
Joshua 10:13. And the sun stood still, and the moon stayed, until the people had avenged themselves upon their enemies. Is it not written in the book of Joshua? So the sun stood still in the midst of heaven, and hastened not to go down about a whole day.
Judges 5:20. They fought from heaven, the stars in their courses fought against Sisera.
Psalm 19:1-6. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Their line is gone out through all the earth, and their words to the end of the world. In them hath he set a tabernacle for the sun, which is as a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, and rejoiceth as a strong man to run a race. His going forth is from the end of the heaven, and his circuit unto the ends of it, and there is nothing hid from the heat thereof. Psalm 136. To him that made great lights, for his mercy endureth forever. The sun to rule the day, for his mercy endureth forever. The moon and stars to rule the night, for his mercy endureth forever.
Psalm 147:4. He telleth the number of the stars, he calleth them all by their names. Psalm 148:3. Praise ye him, sun and moon, praise him, all ye stars of light.
Ecclesiastes 1:5. The sun also ariseth, and the sun goeth down, and hasteth to his place where he arose.
Isaiah 13:9-10. Behold, the day of the Lord cometh, cruel both with wrath and fierce anger, to lay the land desolate, and he shall destroy the sinners thereof out of it. For the stars of heaven and the constellations thereof shall not give their light. The sun shall be darkened in his going forth, and the moon shall not cause her light to shine.
Isaiah 38:8. Behold, I will bring again the shadow of the degrees which has gone down in the sundial of Ahaz. 10 degrees backwards. So the sun returned 10 degrees, by which degrees it was gone down.
Ezekiel 32:7-8. And when I shall put thee out, I will cover the heaven and make the stars thereof dark. I will cover the sun with a cloud, and the moon shall not give her light. All the bright lights of heaven will I make dark over thee, and set darkness upon thy land, saith the Lord. Daniel 8:10. And it waxed great, even to the hosts of heaven, and it cast down some of the hosts and of the stars to the ground, and stamped upon them. Joel 2:10. The earth shall quake before them, the heavens shall tremble, the sun and the moon shall be dark, and the stars shall withdraw their shining. Amos 5:26. But ye have borne the tabernacle of your Moloch, and chewen your images, the star of your God, which ye made to yourselves.
Habakkuk 3:11. The sun and moon stood still in their habitation. At the light of thine arrows they went, and at the shining of thy glittering spear.
Matthew 24:29. Immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. Acts 7:43. Yea, ye took up the tabernacle of Moloch, and the star of your god Remphan, figures which ye made to worship them, and I will carry you away beyond Babylon. 1 Corinthians 15:41. There is one glory of the sun, and another glory of the moon, and another glory of the stars, and one star differeth from another star in glory. Revelation 1:20. The mystery of the seven stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks, the seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Revelation 6:13. And the stars of heaven fell onto the earth, even as a fig casteth her untimely figs when she is shaken of a mighty wind. Revelation 8:10-12. And the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp. And it fell upon the third part of the rivers, and upon the fountains of rivers. And the name of the star is called Wormwood. And the third part of the waters became wormwood. And many men died of the waters, because they were made bitter. And the fourth angel sounded, and the third part of the sun was smitten, and the third part of the moon, and the third part of the stars, so as the third part of them was darkened, and the day shone not for a third part of it, and the night likewise. Revelation 9:1. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven onto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And Revelation 12:4. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born. Again, applying no preconceived notions upon the text, how do you imagine a newcomer to the scriptures would view the heavens, earth, sun, moon, and stars just based on what you've read here? You've got two pictures to look at. Hopefully you were looking at them as we were going through this. I got to say, if I'm being completely honest, removing all of my preconceived biases, the image on the right is a much better fit than the image on the left. And you'll also note the number of times that the shaking of the heavens was related to the shaking of the earth. That makes absolutely no sense in the usual understanding of the heavens as just the atmosphere. You know, three heavens, the atmosphere, space, and where God lives. How can all of that shake as a result of the earth quaking? Unless the heaven is indeed attached to the earth, such that when the earth is shaken, the heavens shake also. You may also be wondering why I put some of the scriptures that I used for references to the sun, moon, and stars. Well, throughout scripture, the stars are represented as angels, not as suns with planets going around them. Over and over and over again, we see the stars representing angels. And we'll also notice that the sun and moon are given genders. The sun is a he and the moon is a she, who, by the way, gives her own light. Just a few things to consider.
If you take it literally, from Genesis to Revelation, the earth is consistently described by Holy Spirit-inspired authors as something like this, where you basically end up with a fixed, not moving, spinning, or orbiting earth that is circular with edges, and it has corners, pillars, foundations, etc. And it's under a dome within which the sun, moon, and stars were placed on day four. Now, I created this model just trying to take the Bible literally. I'm going, okay, if I just read the text for what it says, and I didn't have any preconceived notions in my mind reading the text, what would I come up with? And that's what I came up with. Something set on foundations, circular, carved, you know, in a circle, with a dome within which the sun, moon, and stars were placed. And it seemed to fit all the descriptions that I could see, like Isaiah 66:1, etc. And when I put this drawing out on the internet, somebody sent me this picture of a footstool, and I'm going, oh, wow, that looked almost exactly like the depiction that I came up with just going through the various descriptions. Now, that's the inside of a bigger structure as I put more descriptives to the model, where I believe it's something along these lines, again, taking the scriptures literally, where there are other scriptures that talks about God walking on the circle of heaven. So I've got a circular platform over the dome, which would serve like as a footstool. His throne is up there on the top. And down below is this thing that's circular with a dome set on pillars. Okay, let's go a little crazier here. What about Job 26:7? He stretcheth out the north over the empty space and place and hangeth the earth on nothing. See? Aha! Job proves the earth is hanging in space. I've used that scripture myself numerous times. See? That proves it. The earth's hanging in space. Well, the problem is Job had a few things to say even prior to Job 26. In Job 9:6, he acknowledges the pillars of the earth. We see in Job 38, where he's talking about the foundations and all that stuff and laying the foundation. Other authors in 1 Samuel, we see the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon the pillars. Huh. So could it be then that Job's not contradicting himself or others, but there's another way of looking at this? I think Job is confirming that the earth is hanging on no thing. It is not hanging on or from anything. In other words, all through scriptures we see over and over and over again that it is set on pillars. So if I said to you, I'm in want for nothing, you would understand, well, Rob doesn't need anything, right? Well, I think that's in the context of what Job himself has said in chapter 9 as well as in 38, as well as other scriptures, that he's saying the earth's not hanging on anything because all the authors are telling you it's set on pillars, it's on foundations. We see in 1 Samuel 2:8 that the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and he has set the world upon them. The world's sitting on pillars. The foundations were discovered. We got pillars and foundations. It's all through the Old Testament. Psalm 102:25, of old, thou hast laid the foundation of the earth. Proverbs 8:27, when he established the heavens, I was there. When he inscribed a circle on the face of the deep. The dry land appeared out of the face of the deep in Genesis. So we get more detail here from these various authors, and there are others. I just didn't have the ability to fit them all on one slide right here. But these are really good to get us started. When we see that the dry land appeared as a result of Yahuwah inscribing a circle on the face of the deep, look up the Hebrew word for inscribe. We see that the Hebrew word is chakak, or kalkak, however you pronounce it, I'm not sure. But basically it means to engrave or to carve something into something else, as if chiseling into like the stone for like the Ten Commandments. Please note, you cannot carve a ball into stone. However, you can inscribe a circle into stone, which is what the text says. The word circle is the word chug, which means circle. When we continue to look at this, we see that Isaiah is one of the last authors to write in this regard. A lot of people, when they're describing the earth, want to go to Isaiah 40:22, but you have to realize Isaiah is building upon all the people who had written before him, like Job and like David and like Solomon and like Moses. So when we get to Isaiah 40:22, which is a verse I have used myself to describe the earth, it says, it is he that sitteth upon the circle of the earth. Well, I took Hebrew 101 twice, So that should give you an indication of my aptitude for learning Hebrew. And some may say, I don't even have that great a handle on English. Whatever the case may be, language 101, words mean things. And what's interesting about this, especially if you're a King James only type, Isaiah knew the difference between ball and a circle. In Isaiah 22:18, he talks about a ball. The Hebrew word used there is dur, ball. He chose a different word when he described the earth, and staying consistent with the other authors who came before him in that regard. So Isaiah clearly knew the difference. The King James translators knew the difference. Now the question is, do we know the difference? Google helps you if you want to Google ball or Google circle. You might get images such as this. So some say when God looked down on the earth, he saw a circle. Well, if he's looking down from the north, you don't get a circle. The only time you get a circle is if you're either sitting on the sun or directly in between the sun and the earth. If you're looking from any other direction, you get something like that when you're looking down. So I'm just going to put this out there for consideration. I'm not telling you what I believe. I am just putting this out there for consideration. This is a ball. This is a circle. Take with it whatever you want. Now let's revisit what I started with, the three responses. Let's do a little checkup on you. What? Are you out of your mind? I can see the progression. I'm not oblivious to it. Go buy stock in tinfoil, dude. You're a stupid idiot. Okay, what did I say? Search and see if these things be true. Don't believe me. I'm just reading scripture to you up here. Remember? Prove and test all things. Keep doing it. Let's go. How many of you have heard of this game, Whisper Down the Lane? Right? We've all heard it. We played it as a kid, right? Who is most likely to have the truth? The one closest or the one farthest away from the original source of information? All right. So if we imagine these six individuals here as 6,000 years of human history, the problem is when you go to the one closest to the source material, all through the ancient world, they're depicting the earth like this. They're all doing it. Not just the Hebrews, the Sumerians, the Babylonians, even the Greeks until about 200 BC or so, the Egyptians. All of them had this worldview of the cosmos. This is another graphic somebody did depicting the various verses, and these aren't even all the verses, but the various verses that support this idea or at least indicate this idea. Now, I produced a video some of you may have seen a while back called Flat Earth, a Doctor, and the Village Idiot. And I'm the village idiot in that story. And in that story, I was saying, okay, when I started doing this and posting videos and showing this stuff, of course, everybody thought I was an idiot, lost my mind, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So then I found a highly respected individual, Dr. Michael Heiser. Some of you may know him. He's a Semitic language expert. He's the go-to guy everybody usually goes to when they think I'm crazy. Skiba says this, what do you say? But what was interesting is in his video, he does a whole 25-minute long presentation, about 20, 25 minutes or so, where he goes through the scriptures line by line, and he starts, it says, if we take the scriptures literally, this is what you end up with. And he's on staff at Logos Bible Software, which is staffed by a lot of very intelligent people with letters after their name. And they acknowledge in this very expensive software, one of the premier software, Bible study softwares that you can buy on the market today, they have this graphic right here, created by Logos Bible Software, showing that if you take a literal view of the scriptures, this was the Hebraic concept of the universe.
I found some interesting articles that were written actually a couple of years ago, back in 2012, concerning the idea of taking the Bible literally. And I think it's really worth considering if your view is that we should take it that way. And if you regularly preach along those lines, like Doug Hamp and I have on the Quest for Truth show, we've done over 25 episodes talking about we should take the Bible literally. I mean, if you regularly preach and talk that way, then this is an issue. This flat earth thing is an issue that we have got to deal with. And let me read one of these articles here. It's called Fundamentalists Have the Courage of Your Convictions. And it was written in September, interestingly enough, September 11th, 2012. I'm just going to read this here. It says, I have recently been working through Genesis 1 in my devotional times, and I have had cause to revisit the ancient cosmology of the biblical Israel. No big surprise here, but as is well known, the cosmos of the biblical text is one in which the earth is flat, though in some versions circular, like a round tabletop. Above the earth is a giant solid dome, the firmament, that keeps the chaotic waters above the earth at bay. The sun, moon, and stars are located this side of the dome. So during the flood, the only time in the Bible when rain fell from above the firmament, through the floodgates of the heavens rather than from clouds, we need to understand that the rain came from the other side of the sun, moon, and stars. It was a partial undoing of day two in Genesis 1. I wonder why fundamentalists are so keen to believe in a literal seven-day creation and yet do not campaign against spaceflight in case someone crashes into the Sky Dome and cracks it, or organize recruitment drives for the Flat Earth Society. If you really want to use the Bible to derive cosmology, then it seems the way to go. Of course, fundamentalists realize that such views are simply not live possibilities, even for people with as firm convictions as they have. So they argue that the world in the Bible is not flat, but actually spherical. Wow! How could biblical authors know that? Proof of inspiration, right? And that the firmament is not a solid sky dome, but something else. What the something else is will vary depending on who you talk to. Alas, the arguments used to support a spherical earth in the Bible don't work while the flat earth case is very strong. The same goes for the sky dome. The case for a solid dome is very strong, as evangelical scholar Paul Seeley demonstrated some years ago in a couple of articles in the Westminster Theological Journal. And the case against is, at best, weak, despite Greg Beale's attempt to defend it in an otherwise good article on temple cosmology. So the dilemma remains. If one wants to be a thoroughbred fundamentalist, one really ought to believe that the sky is solid with heaven the other side of it, and that the earth is flat with Sheol, Hades, literally below it. As an aside, I wonder how many fundamentalists would be so keen on big oil if they thought they might accidentally drill down into Hades. Speaking for myself, I agree with the likes of Aquinas and Calvin that God accommodated himself in his communications with humanity. Perhaps God was not interested in correcting the ancient science of ancient Israel. He had bigger fish to fry. But I am inclined that God does not merely speak through Genesis 1 and other biblical texts in spite of its ancient cosmology, but in fact precisely in and through it. That opens up a whole interesting conversation for another time. And that person left off with that conversation back on September 11th of 2012. Well, it seems like Logos Bible software, if you're familiar with some of the Bible study tools out there, a lot of you may even use this software. Logos Bible software is one of those high-end, you know, fairly expensive softwares that helps you to do in-depth Bible study. Really, it seems like they're the ones that stirred up this hornet's nest long before the recent surge of interest in the flat earth hit social media. If you go in online and just do a Google search for flat earth Bible, you'll probably see a really nice, well-drawn depiction done by Logos Bible Software under the heading Ancient Hebrew Conception of the Universe. And it's a circular drawing with the blue waters above the firmament and the great deep below, showing a black firmament that separates the water from the waters, and a flat plain earth that has depth to it with Sheol in the middle set upon foundations. And they are visually depicting with that graphic from Logos Bible software what the biblical cosmology is. And there's another article that I saw called Too Literal, that was written 2 months later in 2012, November 9th. So the one I read before was September 11th, 2012. This is November 9th, 2012. Another person wrote an article called Too Literal? And this person says, let's see. When I opened up Logos 5, that's Logos Bible software, a moment ago, I saw the following graphic on one of the home pages. And he has a depiction of that graphic right there that I just described. And this person says, I've seen many graphics like this one over the years, and they're often accompanied by some sort of commentary that tells us how rudimentary ancient Near Eastern cosmology was. Now, I don't have any stats on this, but personal observation tells me that many of the folks who say this are quite often the same folks who mock young Earth creationists for reading the Bible too literally. But as I looked at this graphic, I can't help but wonder if perhaps they're reading the Bible too literally themselves. What if ancient Near East cosmology is much more sophisticated than it's given credit for, and the folks who suggest that ancient Near Eastern peoples were uninformed are themselves uninformed? Could there be a not so subtle irony here? By the way, really nice graphic, it says. So, you know, there's all kinds of people in the church that believe in the gap theory, for instance, that there was an earth before Genesis 1-2. You know, there's a gap between Genesis 1-1 and Genesis 1-2. There are some that believe in theistic evolution, that evolution is true, but God was the creative force behind making it happen. There are young earth creationists, who I would consider myself one of these types of people, that believes in a literal six-day creation that took place roughly 6,000 years ago. There are people already debating these things, and each one is claiming to take the Bible literal or accusing others of being too literal, taking the Bible too literal. You're just taking it too literal. It doesn't really mean that, you know. So I guess the question is, do you, listener, if you are a Bible-believing Christian — I realize there are people here that may not be, but this, I'm specifically asking this question to people who claim to be Christians, who claim to believe the Bible as truth — do you really claim to take the Bible literally? This is a question I now have to ask myself, okay? Now, if you answer yes, that you do take the Bible literally, well, like it or not, you're hosed. Welcome to the Flat Earth Club. You simply can't get out of that. If you can't accept the clear and precise Hebrew cosmology as written in the text, then you can no longer ever claim to take the Bible literally. Suddenly the whole thing becomes one big metaphor, selective symbolism, and moral tales, of which even those tales now have to be in question. Is it all relative and open to private interpretation now? Is it all just poetry? I mean, what does it really mean? I mean, if it's not something we can take literally, then it's open to whatever your interpretation is, whatever you think it means. And if the Holy Spirit of the Creator himself can't inspire the authors of Scripture to get the design of his creation right, through multiple writers at that — I mean, over 40 authors writing over a period of just under 1,500 years — then how can we really trust anything that's written in that text? Do you see the dilemma? Do you see? We kind of find ourselves in a pickle here. And many people are out there saying this whole subject is not important. Well, I mean, it seems like it's critically important, because the truth of the Scriptures is in question now more than ever. And you know, if you don't think you're in a pickle, I certainly do think I'm in a pickle, because I have made, I have spent most of my ministry and most of my Christian life, if I really think back, saying that I take the Bible literally, and that it's true, and that I can take it literally, and I trust it. This is the whole reason I'm even in this debate in the first place. It's why I'm even looking into this stuff at all. It's because when somebody challenged me to prove that we were on a globe using the Scriptures, I had a really hard time doing that. Hopefully you've heard my previous broadcast that I did a couple weeks ago, where I went through the Scriptures. And I show you, Isaiah 40:22, you can't use it for a ball. And you certainly can't use it for a spinning ball going around the sun at 67,000 miles per hour. There's no way you can get a heliocentric spinning ball anywhere in the biblical text. Now, like many, I have used Isaiah 40:22 myself when I used to teach creation science. But I now have to realize and acknowledge that I was applying my own preconceived notions of a spinning ball onto the text when I did that. Because the Hebrew word there, chug, it's circle. It's not ball. Dur is the word that's used for ball in Isaiah 22:18. So clearly Isaiah, who's the only other person, who's the only person, as far as I'm aware of, in the whole of Scripture, who even used that word, ball. So the same guy everybody wants to use to say that, the Bible proves a spherical earth, he's the only guy that used the word ball in the whole Bible, at least as far as I can tell, used in Isaiah 22, used in a totally different word in Isaiah 40:22 regarding the earth. Okay, so once I realize that, I'm going, oh boy. I've got to look into this. And that's what I've been doing for the last several weeks now. And, we only got about 5 minutes before we go to break already. When I come back from the break, I'm going to play something by Michael Heiser. You know, first of all, I posted a note on Facebook called "Pay No Attention to the Village Idiot." And I said, so apparently I've now earned the reputation as the Facebook Village Idiot these days, and probably YouTube as well, at least according to the internet talk show buzz. I've heard some people tell me that they're mocking me on various radio talk shows and stuff like that, bringing my name up. And of course, the wildly active gossip mill is chiming in as well. And about the time that I was becoming aware of how much my name is being drugged through the mud, I found an article written by Dr. Michael Heiser. It was written about 3 years ago. In the article, he wrote, literal creationists are actually only selective literalists, or, as I would call them, inconsistent literalists. If one was truly consistent in interpreting the creation description of Genesis 1 at face value, along with other creation descriptions in both testaments, you'd come out with a round, flat earth complete with solid dome over the earth and earth supported by pillars with Sheol underneath, etc. But creationists who claim the literal mantle don't do that, since the results are clearly non-scientific. My view, this is Dr. Michael Heiser now, as readers know, is that we ought to simply let the text say what it says and let it be what it is. It was God's choice to prompt people living millennia ago to produce this thing we call the Bible. And so we dishonor it if we impose our own interpretive context on it. Our modern evangelical contexts are alien to the Bible. Frankly, any context other than the context in which the biblical writers were moved to write is foreign to the Bible. So who's the literalist now, he says. I've pointed out this inconsistency before, for example, my online lecture about Genesis and its pre-scientific cosmology. What Genesis describes is consistent with all other ancient Near Eastern creation models and shares the vocabulary and motifs of those other pre-scientific cosmologies. That's Dr. Michael Heiser. Now, if you want to get to know who this guy is, you can check him out on logos.com. Go to logos.com for Logos Bible Software. logos.com/academic/bio/Heiser. And you'll see he earned his PhD in Hebrew Bible and Semitic languages at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. Before going to UW-Madison, Mike earned an MA in ancient history from the University of Pennsylvania. Major fields were ancient Israel and Egyptology, and another MA from the University of Wisconsin-Madison, Hebrew Studies. He also attended Dallas Theological Seminary. Mike's undergraduate degree is from Bob Jones University, but he also attended Bible College for 3 years. Mike's dissertation was entitled "The Divine Council in Late Canonical and Non-Canonical Second Temple Jewish Literature." The dissertation sought to discern the ancient Canaanite and Israelite roots of Jewish binatarian monotheism and the early church's high Christology. Because of his coursework, Mike can do translation work in roughly a dozen ancient languages, among them Biblical Hebrew, Greek, Aramaic, Egyptian hieroglyphs, and Ugaritic cuneiform. He has also studied Akkadian and Sumerian independently. Okay? So, I mean, he's got more to that bio. I mean, there's like 1, 2, 3, 4 more paragraphs you can read on the guy. He's a highly educated individual. Okay? He's a biblical scholar. He's a Semitic language expert with letters after his name. He's like the go-to guy for ancient Near Eastern languages and cultural contexts that nearly everyone around here, in the internet community, they all like to go run to this guy for validation of biblical Hebrew and Greek concepts. Often they'll do so while, mocking me in the process. A pastime that even he has engaged in on more than one occasion. And yet, he has said exactly what I've been saying regarding the cosmology of the ancient world. Even though I've never consulted anything that he's ever written on this issue until just recently. That's right. Believe it or not,
I actually done come to that same conclusion all by my silly self without spending all that money to go to school.
But if you don't want to listen to the village idiot, then at least listen to Dr. Michael Heiser. And welcome back to the Revolutionary Radio Project. I am your host, Rob Skiba, otherwise known as the Village Idiot. Right before the break, I was talking about Dr. Michael Heiser, super smart, brilliant guy who knows everything about the ancient Near East. He was saying exactly what I've been saying regarding the biblical cosmology. And if you don't believe me, I'm going to play some clips from a online lecture that he has posted on Vimeo. It was dated September 29th, 2010, and he went through many, if not the exact same scriptures that I went through in the previous broadcast where I was going through the Bible, showing you all the various verses that support a stationary, flat, enclosed earth under domes, set on pillars, etc. Right? So here is some clips from his online lecture.
The Old Testament shares terms and ideas with the ancient Near Eastern pagans. Again, we talked a little bit about this last week. This should not be a surprise because there are similarities between the conception of how the world that we experience was made that are shared with Israel's neighbors. We see these terms as metaphorical, the terms that I'm going to cover tonight. We look at them. You know, when the Old Testament says something like that the sky is supported by pillars, oh, that's just metaphorical. It's just poetic. To us, it is. And you know why? Because we have a scientific worldview. That's why. They didn't. They were serious. No ancient person ever scaled a mountain. Do you realize that? Like the tall mountains? Because it takes oxygen, they freeze. I mean, all this kind of special equipment. There's no record that any of them ever did it. Okay, it wasn't until the 15th century that we have, you know, the whole issue resolved of can you sail this way and come out the other? You know, the whole idea about the earth being a globe and all that kind of stuff, that was debated up into the 15th century. We look at that and go, oh, you know, it's just poetic. It is to us. But what I'm going to say is, again, back to my introduction, if you take it literally, you have to give them the benefit of the doubt. They were serious about it. All these concepts and even some of the terms are part of ancient Near Eastern cosmology. In other words, what I'll show you tonight, the division of the world, what the world looks like in Israelite cosmology, you can find the same descriptions anywhere else. Egypt, Mesopotamia, you know, ancient Syria, the Hittites, whatever. Because this was a common worldview. Now, if we say that Israel knew better through special divine revelation, then we have a problem. Then we have to say that the literature of the pagans, I mean, somehow they knew too. Did God speak to them? Where'd they get that information? I really don't want pagan literature to be in any way even looking inspired. Okay, that opens a real can of worms for inspiration. It's just ground we need to stay away from, and for good reason. It's legitimate to stay away from it. If we let the Bible be what it is, though, We can claim it's unique theologically in what it says about God. But if not, then pagan literature is essentially on the same level. And trust me, you don't want to go there. You want it to be unique. Let's get into it here. Exodus 24. Israelite cosmology has three tiers. This is the Ten Commandments passage. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. Three levels. New Testament is the same. Philippians 2:8, verse 10. So that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth. What, like the worms? No. We're going to see what they were thinking here. Revelation 5, heaven, earth, under the earth. It's a three-tiered cosmology. This is what it would look like. I didn't make this graphic, which is why it looks cool. Okay. Somebody gave this to me because they hated, honestly, at Western, they hated the one I used, and so they gave me this one. This is a three-tiered cosmology. There's God. We're going to see it in the verses I'll show you, that God lives above the vault of heaven, the firmament. And in the firmament, you have windows and doors. And you have the earth. We're going to see verses that talk about the ends of the round, flat earth here. Underneath is Sheol. Sheol can be both the grave, and it can also be the underworld. Okay, it's not quite hell, but it's sort of like hell. We can talk a little bit about it. And then underneath that, we have the great deep. These are all scriptural terms that are on this map. This is what an Israelite, an Egyptian would have had different terms, but the same three-tiered level. Same with the Mesopotamians. Now, they have, theologically, they have dramatically different views of what's going on here. Not just who made it, but what's going on. Views of afterlife, the value of humanity. I mean, it's dramatically different. And I've made the comment before, Genesis is about theological messaging. And there are some dramatic differences in what Israel is saying, the Bible is saying, and anything else. So let's take a look at the parts. Waters above and below the heavens. Genesis 1:6, God said, let there be an expanse. Some translations have firmament. It's rakia in Hebrew. In the midst of the waters. And let it separate the waters from the waters. And God made the expanse, the rakia, and separated the waters that were under the expanse from the waters that were above the expanse. And it was so. And what was that expanse called? Heaven. The heavens, the sky, shamayim in Hebrew. So you have here sky, okay, and you have waters above the sky, and of course you've got waters below down here, but then you have, you know, the atmospheric heavens as well. Psalm 148 mentions the waters that are above the heavens. That's after the flood. Did you catch that? Because a lot of people want to say, oh, the waters above, they went away with the flood. See, the firmament was this canopy thing, and it was there, and then the flood, it just went away. And no, it wasn't. According to the psalmist, he's still referring to it. Proverbs 8, when he established the heavens, I was there. When he drew a circle on the face of the deep, isn't that interesting? We'll get to that circle on the face of the deep. When he made firm the skies above. Made firm is amatz in Hebrew. It is the same verb for letting a tree grow firm, hard. Ancient cosmology across the board believed that the sky was this dome over the earth and it was solid. Kind of like the Truman Show. Okay? They believed that the stars were affixed to it. Some of the stars never moved, but other ones did. And the ones that did, this is why the word stars is attributed to the sons of God and to angels in biblical literature. They believed that the stars were animate beings, that they were really divine beings, and then they'd come to earth as angels, but they lived up there. And those were the ones that moved. Why? Because movement shows what? If something moves, it's alive. Okay? Again, they can't take a rocket and go up and check it out. They believe that this is there's a solid expanse over them. Another passage, Job 37, verse 18. Can you, like him, speaking of Job, drawing the dramatically poor comparison of God and Job, of course we know who's going to win there, but can you, like him, spread out the skies hard, kazak, hard as cast metal, mutsak, as a metal mirror? Mutsak is the same word used in the casting of the laver, the tabernacle where they would wash. It's solid. It's also the same terminology used for flint rock. Again, these passages point to the belief that there's a dome, the sky is a dome, and it's solid. And God lives above it, we live below it. Job 22, did I skip one? No, I didn't. But you say, what does God know? Can he judge through the deep darkness? Thick clouds veil him so that he does not see, and he walks on the vault of heaven. That's where God lives. It's his address. And before we think, oh, that's quaint. How cute. We think that, don't we? If a little child would ask you, where does God live? Up there. Is there something wrong with that answer? I don't think there's anything wrong with it. Use it, because there's the sense that God lives off planet. Why? Because he created the earth for us. He doesn't need it. He's independent of it. He transcends it. That's all it is. It's very normal. Amos 9:6, he builds his upper chambers in the heavens and founds his vault upon the earth. The vault upon the earth. Who calls for the waters of the sea and pours them out in the surface of the earth? The Lord is his name. And Psalm 29, Lord sits enthroned over the flood. Let's go back here. We talk about the middle tier now, the earth. Here's a God's eye view of the world. If God is sitting above the firmament and looking down at it, what does he see? This is where we get Genesis 1:9. God said, let the waters under the heavens be gathered together into one place. Waters, plural, one place. How can you get all the waters in one place and then still call them seas? And the dry land appeared. That's how you get it. All the waters, one place, earth, but they're still seas. Again, depending on what direction you're coming from or where you're at. Because if you're over here, you're going to call this something sea, and you can't really see what's going on over here. So if you live on the other side, that's another sea. But you got all the seas together. Proverbs 8, when he established the heavens, I was there when he drew a circle on the face of the deep. Circular. He made firm the skies above, so on and so forth. Here's an interesting one. He has inscribed a circle on the face of the waters at the boundary between light and darkness. What's the boundary between light and darkness? Think about it. You all know the answer to this. What's the boundary? Think literally. What's the boundary between light and darkness? Does it get dark here? Does it get light here? Where's the boundary? The horizon. That's the boundary between light and darkness. If this is your view of the world, your horizon is right here. That's where the firmament ends and it meets. It's stopping the waters from going any further. And it goes all the way around, the whole thing. Because if you're on a circular earth, everywhere you look, there's a horizon, the place where light and dark meet. Again, I told you I'm going to be a flaming literalist tonight. I'm going to take them absolutely at their word. Vault of the heavens, pillars and mountains, the pillars of heaven tremble and are astounded at his rebuke. Oh, that's just metaphor and poetry. Yeah, to us it is. If you ask them, it's like, well, there's that big mountain thing. I mean, that's holding up the sky. Duh. If you don't believe it, go find, I mean, how are you going to find out any different? You know, obviously we can, but, you know, the means to do that isn't with them. 2 Samuel 28, the earth reeled and rocked, the foundations of the heavens trembled and quaked because God was angry. Windows and doors, and that day all the fountains of the great deep burst forth, and the windows of the heavens were opened. The fountains of the deep and the windows of the heavens were closed. Psalm 78, yet he commanded the skies above and opened the doors of heaven. Again, familiar phrases. Pillars under the earth, supporting the earth. Again, look at the language. For the pillars of the earth are the Lord's, and on them he has set the world. You betcha. It's not Marduk. It's not that silly Ptah in Egypt. It's Yahweh who did that. Isn't that amazing? I mean, an Israelite would want you to marvel. He would think you're insane if you didn't. Either that or a pagan. Job 38:4. Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? On what were its bases sunk? Or who laid its cornerstone? He set the earth on its foundations so that it should never be moved. To him who spread out the earth above the waters. Again, think of the circle with the earth in the middle. For his steadfast love endures forever. Now, that is a very brief overview of Old Testament cosmology. And I'm coming back to this slide. But I think I'd kind of like to go back to, well, some of us won't have the context for it. Let's just end here. There is a passage, if any of you bring it up in Q&A, I have more slides about it, but I'm going to end here, that relates to cosmology that might have popped in your head as far as a question, dealing with the Earth's shape, as it will. But the message I want you to take away again is Genesis is about theological messaging. Just like with our illustration, we spent a long time leading up to the cosmology slides, the conversation between the six-year-old and the scientist. When you accept the way that the critic frames the debate, you're not going to get very far. If you remember the conversation, the six-year-old, God made my baby brother. And the scientist says, no, he didn't. Your mommy and daddy did. I asked you who was right. And we said, they're both right. Then I asked you who was wrong. And we said, they're both wrong. But we can parse that because we separate mentally the truth claim, the message, the assertion, the truth assertion being put out, and we immediately contextualize the person's worldview, and even if it's flawed like the six-year-old's was, her point is still correct. And if we look at Genesis this way, it doesn't matter that Genesis is, and the rest of the Bible is littered with this kind of cosmological language because God didn't bother to change the culture. He could have if he wanted to. He didn't care. If he had cared, he would have done it. The only other conclusion is that he couldn't, and then you have a problem with omnipotence. Okay? God doesn't care. I'm coming to these people at this time, in this place. It's second millennium BC. They don't know it's BC yet because Jesus doesn't come. But it's a long time, okay, way, 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 way back. And I'm going to give them a message, and they're going to do the best they can under my influence to express it. I'm going to watch as they write. If they goof up, I'm going to send somebody along. Yeah, go fix that. You know, they didn't quite get it right. Somebody will come along and clean that up a little bit. When it gets done with the process, God can look at this thing we call the Bible and say, good job. It's pretty good. I'm satisfied with that. But all of that content is fixed in a particular worldview that we don't have. Okay, we have to let it be what it is. And let God let God's decision to do it that way settle with us. And my challenge to you is, try it. Okay, if you do that, you don't need to justify it to science. They need to justify why they're criticizing it for not being what it was never intended to be. And that would be an interesting conversation. Don't accept that the way they articulate the debate.
All right, that's where I'll end that. So, clearly, Dr. Michael Heiser fully acknowledges that the Bible absolutely argues in favor of a still flat circular earth with a dome over it. I mean, let that sink in, guys. Go read this guy's bio. A Semitic language expert acknowledges that the Hebrews had the same cosmology as the ancient Near East, which was just the same way it's depicted in the Logos Bible software picture. Now, all the stuff that I've been referring to in this broadcast so far came as a result of me trying to confirm that Logos actually made that picture, because I've used that picture quite a bit, and, you know, people get creative with Photoshop sometimes, so I wanted to make sure that was a legitimate image created by Logos Bible Software, which is a highly respected Bible tool software, you know, program. So as I'm searching to confirm that that was in fact created by Logos Bible Software, I'm finding all these articles that I've been referring to in this broadcast so far, and then I found this video of Michael Heiser saying that he was being a flaming literalist, taking the Bible literally, and showing that this is what the scriptures say. Now, this guy is a language expert. He's a Semitic language expert. He totally understands the Hebrew language. So all you people out there trying to use chug for ball, go talk to him. Because he's like, nope, it's a circle. You know, he's the go-to guy, but he wants to go, you know, run to confirm, you know, this Hebrew or Greek stuff. And he's telling you that it's Isaiah 40:22 does not support a ball. And the Hebrew people, they, and the ancient Near Eastern people, they understood that the earth was a circle, flat. Now, I said it, and people mocked me, and they dismissed it, and they stated that the whole biblical flat earth thing, you know, that was just a myth that showed up a couple hundred years ago to make Christians look stupid. No, guys. It was the dominant view of the ancient world. Face it, that's what it was until about 1,500 years ago. And this is confirmed, again, by a highly educated intellectual who's one of the big content contributors to Logos Bible Software, and he's got alphabet soup, you know, style name with letters after it. Okay, so again, if you don't want to believe me, the village idiot, then believe him. I mean, the guy, you know, he paid lots of money so people would actually acknowledge that he knows what he's talking about. Now, that said, you heard him say that Genesis is about theological messaging. And he's basically making the case that the Bible is just there to give us theology, you know, how to understand our relationship with God. Well, hey, that's true. But the creator of the cosmos told several authors, and he read a bunch of them, and I put a whole bunch more in the stuff that I wrote long before I ever read any of his stuff. You know, the Holy Spirit inspired these guys to describe the earth a very specific way. You know, Mike says, well, you know, God never felt the need to correct them in their apparent wrong interpretation or understanding. Well, wait a minute. Why would God have to correct them? He's the one that inspired them to write it in the first place. He'd have to correct himself. He's the one that told them to write it that way. So if you want to blame somebody about where this flat earth thing comes from, blame God, because he's the one that told the authors to write it this way. You know, it's the facts of the facts. That's what the Bible says. If you're going to trust the Bible, then there you go. Welcome to my side of this whole thing. I can't let this thing go because I do trust the Bible, and I'd say you could take it literally, and I've been known for preaching that. So now I'm in a pickle. And so, I mean, where does this leave us? Well, for me, it leaves me still on the quest for truth. I haven't arrived yet. I haven't arrived to a conclusion. And one of the things I realized I needed to do was take a step back and see how we got here. Okay, Dr. Michael Heiser admits, you heard his presentation, that the entire ancient Near East believed this way. The earth was fixed on pillars under a dome, right? Now, his final position on it, I'm going to quote from an article that I read by him. He said, if God's point had been to give us scientific precision, he would have done so, and we'd probably not understand it unless we want to presume our own knowledge of the created world has pretty much solved everything and answered all the questions, in which case you must be doing your science reading in popular magazines. The point is, no one alive today can handle all the detail known to the mind of God. And the same goes for the second millennium BC writer. But the fact that we don't have this sort of indecipherable item informs us that such wasn't the goal of inspiration. And so the scientific details cannot be viewed as the truth claim assertion God meant to be communicated to posterity. As such, it is unreasonable to define inerrancy / errancy by such criteria. Okay, well, you know what? Maybe I'm just dumb enough to imagine that it would have been quite easy for Yahuwah to have described the earth as a spinning ball going around the sun if he meant to reveal the truth of his creation that way. And by the way, he did spend a lot of time telling multiple authors about the nature of our earth, the sun, moon, and stars, as we have just seen in his presentation as well as in the multitude of scriptures that I went to in some of the previous sessions on my blog. Right? I mean, he spent a lot of time going, telling us all this stuff. So clearly, I mean, it was on his mind to tell human beings something about the cosmos. So then why describe it totally different from scientific reality? I mean, it's not like the ancients couldn't imagine something spherical or the idea that we could be, you know, we as an earth, we could be the ones moving around a stationary sun. I mean, somehow the ancients managed to build unbelievably amazing megalithic structures, and they did so making astrological observations and calculations that we still to this day can't figure out. I mean, many of the megalithic structures were designed to be ways to observe the movement of the stars. I mean, and the further back we go, the more impressive it gets. So I'm quite sure they could have handled the truth concerning the science we all believe today. I mean, really, it's not like a big deal. I mean, if God meant to say that we are on a globe, they understood what a three-dimensional ball is. I mean, if they, you know, looked at a stone, well, it's round, you know, it has spherical dimensions, you know. I mean, it's not like a sphere was, you know, something we didn't figure out till, you know, recently. And they had clear understanding of a lot more of the cosmos than you and I do to have built and done the things that they did. So, I mean, if God really wanted to describe the earth, they were capable of understanding that concept. If he was to describe it as earth going around the sun instead of the sun apparently moving around the earth. There's over 60 scriptures in the Bible talking about the sun, moon, and stars moving over us, zero scriptures ever mentioning the earth moving, rotating, spinning, or orbiting. None. To my simple, uneducated brain, Dr. Michael Heiser's illustration of the six-year-old child, the child's mindset, where did we, you know, babies come from, it doesn't quite seem to fit the example of Holy Spirit-inspired text written by the prophets of the creator of the cosmos.
This was the Hebraic concept of the universe, and they were not alone. Like I said, there are many, many other cultures that believe the same thing. So looking at our whisper down the line, we have the guys toward the source material saying, we are on a circular, still flat earth set on pillars under a dome within which are the sun, moon, and stars. We get to the end of the line where we are today, and I heard we live on a spinning heliocentric ball in an ever-expanding universe. Huh. Which one is it anyway? If you read the textbooks would tell you that we are on an oblate spheroid. You got this guy right here saying, the Earth is really pear-shaped. Neil deGrasse Tyson says the Earth is pear-shaped. Then, of course, everything NASA puts out shows us pictures time and time again of a perfect sphere. And then we have the Bible over here saying, well, you live in a snow globe. So, which one is it? I'm asking the question because I'm asking the question.